Friends, welcome to this monthly meeting we are having under the auspices of ISHA, the Institute for the Study of Human Awareness. The idea of having these meetings on a monthly basis is to keep us on track on the spiritual path. Our minds being what they are, we lose track very quickly because of the diversions and distractions that are around us in our daily life. And that is why we need a little re-trigger to get back on track and change our priorities as they ought to be, which should be that the priority of our purpose of human life is to go back home, and it should be number one. It should be priority number one that we have to take steps of what will happen after we die in this physical body. Do we want to come back into this cycle of rebirth, or do we want to go back home? If we are fed up of our stay here, if we feel we have had enough of it, if we feel this is not our home, then these are the signs that we are a seeker of our true home. And when you are a seeker of a true home, on this planet or anywhere else, if you are a seeker of your true home, want to go back to your true home, a master will appear in your life, sometimes by coincidence, sometimes by a strange set of circumstances, but a master will appear in your life. It is so set up already. It is not something new. This arrangement has been set up by our own totality of consciousness before this creation came into being. Which means we have ourselves made an arrangement that when we are tired of this journey into a foreign land of physical, astral and causal planes, all planes working under the power of our own mind and not of our soul or spirit, we have made an arrangement ourselves at inception that when we want to go back home and we are tired of this, we have had enough of it, a master will appear in our life. And he will guide us to go back to our true home. It can be anybody. A master does not have special wings to fly. He is a human being, just like us. A master acts just like us, with no difference. In fact, a few friends of mine have written to me about a master who says the masters know nothing. And all that you are getting is from within yourself. The outside form of the master is merely a human being created like all other human beings by your own projection of consciousness. Therefore, how could a person who is your own projection of your own mind be a master or take you back home? So what takes you back home is your own self. That saint who said these things, his name was Baba Fakir Chand. Baba Fakir Chand lived in a town in India called Hoshiarpur. As it happened, my dad was teaching in a college in the same town of Hoshiarpur. And I was studying in that college. And so we had access to Baba Fakir Chand, who was our neighbor there. And he was following the line of Swamiji through Data Dayal, who was his master. And he was carrying on the work of a regular perfect living master, and he was a perfect living master. But in his discourses, he kept on saying that masters know nothing. In fact, he gave an example that in the First World War, he was in the military, and he was posted in the advanced base office, and three of his disciples, initiated by him, were also in the combat zone, in the war, in the front. One day, those three disciples of Baba Fakir Chand got ambushed by the enemy. And they saw that the enemy was on all four sides. There was no way for them to escape. And therefore they said, now that we are going to die, we'll be killed any time by the enemy. Let us sit together and pray to our master, Baba Fakir Chand, that now we are ready to go back to Sachkhand, our end has come, and please help us. to go back within ourselves to our true home. At that time, the three sat down and they closed their eyes and they felt that Baba Fakir Chand was present there. They opened their eyes and he was standing in front of them. All three of them saw him. They bowed at his feet, which is of course the custom there. And they touched his feet and said, "Thank you, Babaji, for coming here. We thought you were in the back post." He said, "I have come to tell you that you are not going to die today. I have come to tell you that where you are standing, behind that, there is a bush. And you open that bush, cut it off. Under that is a tunnel. That tunnel will take you behind the enemy lines. You'll be safe." And he disappeared while they were watching. So they knew it was not the physical form, but it looked like the physical form. So they removed the bush and found a tunnel. And they came through the tunnel and went out behind the enemy lines, were saved, and ran to the base post to go and say thanks to the master for saving their life. When they reached there, Baba Fakir Chand, who was also in military uniform at that time, he received them and they said, "Thank you very much, master, for saving us." He said, "When did I save you? I have no idea." He said, "You appeared before us. All three of us saw you. And you saved us by telling us a route which you would never imagine, that a tunnel existed there to come out. It's all you are doing. Master, don't pretend that you don't know about it." And Baba Fakir Chand said, "The truth is, I know nothing about it. The truth is that shells were falling outside my tent. I was shivering with fright myself. How could I be going out to save you?" And this story, he has told in his own words in his satsang. And he tells the story. There's another satsang of his, an informal satsang with a group of people. In one, Harjit Singh is sitting and he's addressing most of his remarks to that friend of his. And he says, "People ask me, Babaji, if you know nothing, how are you initiating people? And how are you telling them what to do to have dhyan of the master and to look at me and get the dhyan? Why are you telling them that if you really know nothing?" And in that discourse he describes, he says, "I am not saying that I do nothing. I do everything. But the I that does everything is inside you. I am a projection from the real master who is inside you. I am trying to draw your attention to the inner self, which is the only reality." He said, "Even the astral form, the radiant form of a master that you see in meditation is not real. It's made up. The master you see in physical body outside is not real. It's made up like anything else. If everything around us is Maya, illusion, how can one piece out of it, a human being, be different? So the master is the same form as the rest of the creation, outside, unreal." So Baba Fakir Chand explained that there is only one reality. You can give it any name. You can call it Anami. You call it Satnam. You give it any name. You can call it the ultimate truth. You can call it the total consciousness. It doesn't matter what name you give. That's the only reality. From that reality, everything has been created step by step. Nothing else is real. So when you say that master comes to help us, and that master came and helped you when you were ambushed by the enemy, it is not me. It's not my radiant form. It's none of the forms. It is the truth, the ultimate, the only reality that took the form of a master and helped you. It's the same reality that is taking the form of me as a physical being to help you. But don't start taking things that are created by illusion as reality because they are helpful to you, because you made an arrangement to have this system go to take you back home. He emphasized this point and he said, "I'm sitting in front of you," Fakir Chand says, "and you have come to me for my satsang. I'm giving you a discourse. It will help you. But where will you really get help to go back home? From within yourself. And not only from the experiences you are having within yourself, even they are unreal, only from the ultimate source, which is the only reality. All else is made up. After that, another satsang took place few days later, where his own disciple, one Tarachand, was sitting there, became a saint. They call him as Sant Tarachand. So Sant Tarachand came to see him, and Baba Fakir Chand introduced him and said, "Today Sant Tarachand is going to give a satsang." So Baba Fakir Chand is sitting next to him, and Sant Tarachand is giving a discourse. And what does Sant Tarachand say in front of his master? He says, "Don't believe this guy. If he could do nothing, why am I traveling 1,000 miles to come and have his darshan? Why am I coming to this man if this man is doing nothing and he knows nothing? Why am I running after him?" And he says, "I can tell you the truth. Without coming to this man, I could have got nothing. Therefore, he is a perfect living master in human form, and he can't even deny sitting next to me." And Fakir Chand laughed and smiled. The point he was trying to make, and we discussed these things, my dad and I, with Baba Fakir Chand, because he told us, explained, that people are beginning to worship a man outside as a way to go to Sachkhand, which is not true. Sachkhand has to be found within yourself. People have given up the practice of meditation, thinking, "No, we can go and have a darshan of the Guru, we are fine." So I am encouraging them by telling them the truth. The truth is, the reality lies only inside you and lies at the top, where there is only one. There is no two there. When it becomes two, it becomes unreal. When it is ultimately one, that's the reality. So I am telling them that the reality is one, and they are taking it differently, and they think that all masters know nothing. If they know nothing, why are we running after them? So what is the truth then? People are asking me, and I am giving an answer today because I know Mark is recording this, and it will go to many questioners, same kind of questioners, who are asking that Baba Fakir Chand says the master knows nothing. Is it true? Now the answer, of course, is they know nothing. They are ordinary human beings. But without them, you can get nothing. Without them, without their initiation, without their giving instructions how to go within, without their knowing who you are, without their being able to guess what you are thinking, without being acting so superhuman in the human body, they wouldn't be masters. So they do all these things, but their life is like an ordinary human being. Yeah. People come to me and thinking I am a master. I first of all say, dispel that feeling. No, I am an ordinary person, a seeker, a sevadar of my master. He was a perfect living master, not me. If you experience anything, he is responsible, good or bad. If it's good, praise him. If it's bad, condemn him. He is doing everything, not me. So I secure a very safe place for myself. It's a nice way to present it. But then the difficulty comes when somebody comes to me and he says, "What is the answer?" I said, "What is your question?" He said, "You know it already." And I said, "No, how could I know? No, I don't believe you. You know it already." So give me the answer. I am absolutely nonplussed. I don't know what he's asking, what information he wants, and he's putting it on me. So I herald a guess. Sometimes the guess can be yes. Sometimes the guess can be yes, work on that. Sometimes guess can be And they all work. How do they work? I don't know how they work. So the working is inside them, because they had the question in their heart, they got the answer in themselves. I have frequently said that nobody can ask a question unless you already have the answer to it within your own consciousness. It's hidden somewhere. When you go to a master and ask a question and he answers it, and you say, "Yes, that's right." How do you say that's right if you didn't know it already? It is only a verbalization, a vocalization of an answer which is already in your head. So all the answers to all our questions are already in our head. And by going within and discovering the various layers through which we pass to become human beings, just by having those experiences, we get to know that the answers are inside, and we can see the answers inside ourselves. So that is why, supposing somebody asks me a serious question and I give a stupid answer, he won't accept it. Even if I was a perfect living master, he won't accept it. Because he said, doesn't make sense. So when you say an answer makes sense and you like it, it means you knew it beforehand. It was not visible in front of you. It was hidden behind somewhere in your mind. So the mind is creating all these things. And the mind is a very creative thing. Everything we are seeing around us has been created by the mind. Everything. Three mental worlds to which we have access. The physical world, where we are now sitting in our physical bodies. It has come into being because our reality, our self, our consciousness, which is our only self, a true self, the only reality, the consciousness, which is the only reality, is currently working in a physical body, wearing a physical body, and sitting inside that physical body in the head, behind the eyes, and operating the system. By consciousness, which we can call a soul, soul is pure consciousness. It does not think, it does not see, it does not feel, it has none of these things. The soul is pure consciousness. It can sit inside another apparatus and begin to think, feel, see, do everything. The soul sits inside this physical body, inside the head of a physical person, behind the eyes. That is our true self. A true self that will never change no matter what. A true self that if you go and sleep at night and dream, the one who is dreaming and seeing the dream is the same true self. You go to a higher level of consciousness, to the astral plane, and can fly there. You will be flying the same self that's sitting in the physical body. You go to your true home, it will be the same self that started the journey and is ultimately finding the truth, the totality is the same self. The self never changes. The fact that the self occupies different forms around it creates the experience of different worlds around it. When the self sits inside a physical body, like it is sitting now and we are all assembled here, the self is creating a physical universe for us. If you don't have the physical body, this universe disappears. It can be any change of your form, imaginary or real. Any change of your form changes the universe around you. Therefore, what we are calling an everlasting physical world created by a big bang billions of years ago, in which we have come for a little while, this physical experience around us, this physical world, is being created merely because we are sitting in a physical body. The physical body creates the physical reality around us. The beauty of this whole system of creation is it does not create shadows or illusions, it creates reality. The definition of reality being what we think is real, what we believe is real, what we test out is real. So all our tests to find out what is real are confined to the very experience we are trying to test out if it is real or not. For example, if I want to test if these flowers are real or am I just hallucinating and imagining they are there, what's the next step? I'll touch them. No, they're real. Because I could see them and also touch them. We confirm our reality of things by using the same sense perceptions which are creating the very thing we're trying to verify. That's a big error. You can imagine if you are going to sleep at night and have a dream. In the dream, you're sitting in a chair like I am sitting here. In the dream, there are flowers next to you. And somebody says in the dream to you, do you know, this is not a dream, it's real. You say, no, I think it's a dream. You say, okay, you can see, are these flowers dream flowers or real flowers? And you touch them, they're real. And then you wake up, there's no flowers. There's no chair. There's no friend telling us to check up. And there is no me that was moving and asking this question. The me now becomes one who was sleeping in the bed. Who was that form? What form was that which could sit up and ask questions and touch flowers when then none of them existed? And the belief that they were real was continuously present. The belief of reality was continuously present while we were dreaming. Only when we woke up, we discovered it was unreal. But once we woke up, then these flowers have become real now. Those were dream flowers. But I've woken up now, found real flowers. How do I know they're real? I touched them, they're real. I'm doing the same thing I did in the dream to verify the reality of something, you cannot use it. Use the same system of checks that you are using for creating the first reality. Therefore, we make that mistake and we think things are real because they can be verified by a combination of sense perceptions, and therefore our perceptions is a guide to what is real. When the perception changes, by change of consciousness, level of consciousness, reality changes. Dream becomes real while we're dreaming. It becomes a dream when we wake up. This physical world remains real while we are in the physical world. When we go to a higher level, physical world disappears like a dream. And that world becomes real. And we go to still higher place, both astral world, physical world and dream world all become dreams. And we wake up to something more real. Then we find the mind itself is real. The mind's ability to create is real. And we see the mind creating all these things. Then we find out the only real thing was our mind. And then we find out that the mind itself is part of a universal mind. So we discover the universality of creation. See, now we found the truth. This is the real truth. We are having experience of a real truth of the mind. And then we come across a perfect living master in the human form before we started this exercise to go to the mind. And he tells us the mind is also created. That's not the reality. And he tells us a way to go beyond the mind. We go beyond the mind and find all the things we were real were unreal, created by a process which consciousness has, and the self, the conscious being, was still the same, continuously the same. At the end of the journey, spiritual journey of perfect living masters, not all masters, of perfect living masters is totality of consciousness where there is only one, and that one is real. Not the manifestation of one. The one that creates the one is real. Let me distinguish between that too. People say, let's go to Sachkhand, our true home, because that is real. I'm saying boldly today, even Sachkhand is not real. Nothing created anywhere is real. The creative power, the creator is real. Not the created things, no matter what it is. The created things create their own depth of reality. They look more and more real as we wake up higher and higher. Ultimately, it's complete reality. It's a created reality. But the one who is creating this reality is our consciousness, appearing as an individuated form, as an atma or a soul, right here. Continues to be individuated right up to the mind level, and even beyond the mind, remains individuated as one unit. Ultimately, in our true home, merges with totality and finds that everything that was ever created was all within that one consciousness. Nothing happened outside of it. It is like consciousness is like a daydreaming being. Daydreams, whatever he daydreams, become reality. Something like that. Therefore, consciousness is the power to be conscious of anything it likes. It's an arbitrary consciousness. It is not only arbitrary, it's playful. The word they use in India for this function of consciousness is moj. Moj we have translated as will. It is the creator's will that creates everything. It's the consciousness will that creates everything. In totality of consciousness, it's will that creates everything. Will is not a correct translation. Because the same word moj we use, let's have moj, let's have fun. So it is a fun will, a playful will. Arbitrary, playful will is what the moj of the ultimate totality of consciousness can be termed as. The whole thing has been created for a playful purpose. It's a game. All levels of creation, including our true home, has been created as a game so that consciousness can play around in it. And right now, we are in a certain section of that game. The section we call physical body in a physical world. It's just part of the same game. And we can rise lower, go to dreams, or rise higher into astral experiences. It's still a game. We don't take it as a game. We take it as the only reality, not only reality. We take it as the only reality. Any one level of consciousness which we are experiencing, That level is the only reality. That's beautiful. If we had multiple realities, everything will become sham and become unreal. So by confining ourselves to one level of reality, right now the physical reality, it makes it an absolute reality. That there can be nothing more real than what we are experiencing. And that is why it's the best form the consciousness has used to create reality. Otherwise it would only create illusions. It would create maya, mithya, what they call something that is destroyed, that just comes into being and is destroyed. Something temporary. All those things that are temporary could not be the reality. And all these things are created temporarily. We physical bodies, what life do we have? We have a life of, what, 100 years? Not many people live in each 100 years. Very small fraction of time. Even if we take the physical calculation of time from the Big Bang of billions of years, then 14 billion years earlier, this whole universe started 4.5 billion years ago. This planet came into being where we are sitting, and in that we have a 100-year life. It's like a few seconds. If the clock from 12 to 5 was our total creation, it's just a few seconds we are here. Not even a few seconds. How are we giving so much importance to the few seconds? And if you go to sleep and have a dream, what's the time frame there? Our whole life is a few seconds. Maybe a few minutes. In 1962, I came to the United States for the first time. To stay here and to study here at the university and to learn more about America. In those days, they were studying sleep and dreams in a big way. And I attended one of their courses. I attended with them their experiment they were doing on sleep and wakeful states. They found out by taking subjects in their lab to go to sleep and put electrodes on them, cameras on them to see the rapid eye movements of the eyes and see, monitor all the vital forces, vital signs of the body. They were examining everything, and in the middle of the sleep, when the charts were active, showing that the person was now dreaming, the eyes were moving, rapid eye movement was taking place, they would wake him up and say, "What are you watching?" And the person would describe the kind of dream he or she was having. If the eyelids were moving vertically up and down, the person was woken up, he would describe a scene in which there is a waterfall, something falling down, ourselves falling down. It's a vertical motion going on in the dream sequence and can be read on the movement of the eyes, under the eyelids. If the eye inside the eyelid was shaking like this, you could read outside on the eyelid. Then you wake up, say, "I was watching a tennis match. The balls were going from here." It was a horizontal activity going on in the dream, which was being represented on the eyelids. They were taking pictures of the body. A very stormy scene was going on. Somebody was attacking. The whole body was moving around, turning around while in sleep. So this physical body was totally connected with the events that were taking place in a dream. But the person, the subject, was taking the dream to be the only reality. Then these people would record. The lab people would record what they are saying about the dream. And in the morning, when they woke up, they had no idea they had any of their dreams. They discovered we dream every night, all of us, several times. And no dream lasts more than 12 minutes. They didn't find any case. Some of them last a few minutes. Some of them last less than a minute. Some can last 5 minutes. There was one case that came up while I was still there, in which a person says, when woken up in the middle of the dream, "I can tell you, I saw, when I was a little child, I was seeing my school. Then I was growing up and I remember I met my sweetheart. And then I remember we got engaged. I still remember where that happened. And then I grew up and I had children. I married her and I got children. Then I became a grandpa. Then I still remember my grandchildren. And then I was very sick. And when I was very sick, I woke up. You woken me up." And they timed it. It was about 5 minutes. In 5 minutes, the man lived his whole life. And he had an experience of the whole life. How did they explain that a person can have an experience from childhood till almost death in 5 minutes of physical time? The explanation which I agree with was that we don't see in a dream, we don't see all the scenes play out in real time. We see flashes one after the other, and those flashes create the impression that so much time has passed, and we take it as normal. We, in a dream, we can be in one town now, after 1 second we can be in another town, one time in Chicago doing something, next minute in New York, and the dream, it'll look absolutely real. Nobody has ever questioned in the dream, how could I jump immediately from Chicago to New York at once? In the dream, it looks real. The laws of nature operating in dreams are different than the laws of nature creating the sequences here. So they explained that we have flashes of experience, visual experiences, flashes which come rapidly, but we assume, and by assuming, experience the actual time flow of many years. And I was very happy to hear that explanation, because I knew this is exactly how we live here now. We are not passing through real time here, we are living in flashes here also. The mind creates flashes, we are living in still pictures now. It doesn't look like still, it's like a movie. You go and see a movie on the screen, everybody is moving around, and if you go and see where the projector is, each is a single picture being moved rapidly. If we move it slower than 16 frames per second, it'd be very choppy, we won't see there's any movement. You speed it up, it becomes movement. Here we are moving millions of slides per second in the physical world. It so smoothly runs into it. Why? Because the mind has an ability to use persistence of vision, persistence of an experience, and create continuity and movement and mobility. That is why in the movie we see movement, because they flip the single pictures so fast and they are connected one with the other. The gap between the two of 1/16th of a second or 1/32nd of a second that they are using now, that gap is covered by our mind, and the old picture continues to merge in the new and creates a continuity of movement. This life we are leading is just exactly the same thing. But how will you know it? If you leave the screen where you're seeing the movie and go back into the projector room and see how the scene is being projected. Supposing you are in a movie theater and you are seeing the movie, and somebody says, this is not a movie really. Nothing is moving. It's all still. You don't believe, because you are seeing the movie yourself. Then you have to go back. It's not in front. In front is exactly the movie. You go back, and at the back is a projector. And the projector has a film loaded into it. And that film is all single pictures which are not moving. But the projector is moving them fast. And therefore, on the screen you are seeing movement. And behind the projector is light. The light is what is projecting through the projector and creating the shadows which look like real movement. And you go and verify, it is true that all the time you thought they were real characters, you were identifying with them, you were laughing and crying with them, you were feeling so tense if serious scene would come, you sit on the edge of your chair, taking it real. When you found out that there was no reality, you also found out another thing, that the film was not being made at the time when you were seeing it. It was pre-recorded. The film was loaded into the projector, and the film was shot way back. It was brought to the movie theater and it was put at the back. Now this is a simple simile I'm giving, an example. It's happening to us right now as I speak. What we are seeing is a multi-dimensional screen. Every around us is a multi-dimensional screen. In that, everything is being projected, including our body. What is not projected is the viewer of this movie, who is sitting inside one of the characters of the movie. A little different from the other movie, because in the other movie we sit separate from the screen and therefore we can keep the identification we are just watching a movie if we want to think of it. Most of the time we don't want to think of it. We want to enjoy the movie as reality. But if we know that we are not on the screen, we are sitting aside, it becomes easy to know it's a movie. Here in this movie of physical life, we are sitting in one of the characters. And therefore, the character around us is also part of the movie. And so are all the other characters part of the movie. How do we then, when you're sitting inside a character, look at the projector? Fortunately, the projector is also within the character in which you are sitting. And you go back inside. Ignore the movie for a while. Turn back inside. Go within yourself, inside. And you will find that what you thought was life happening around you was actually a projection of a movie pre-recorded and pasted in your mind right there. That it is not playing real mobile scenes, it's playing single shots even now. And you will see that the projector in which the film is put in, is called the human mind. And the light without which nothing will be visible is your soul, is your consciousness. The consciousness presents itself through the projector of the mind and creates a multidimensional movie around us and looks so real. It's a beautiful thing. How could anybody improve this kind of creation? How could anybody improve on the system by which we can identify completely with the characters of the movie and become a reality of a character ourselves, as if this physical body is our reality? How does it happen? Because we don't look behind. We don't look inside. We look outside. We are continuously watching the screen outside, which looks so real, and therefore you're going through the ups and downs of a movie in which we are participating by sitting in one character. But you can see it. Once you know the truth, I'm sharing this truth with you, that go within and see how the projection is taking place. You can also find out that the entire life that you are leading is totally pre-filmed, predetermined, and you can make no change whatsoever in it. But the part of the movie says, characters say, we can make a change, and you make a change. That change was being recorded in the movie. And the movie is participating with thoughts, which are also part of the movie. Choice making, also part of the movie. Our free will, part of the movie. Therefore, if you want to find the reality, you have to go deeper within yourself, behind the mind. Leave the mind to continue to work, and you go behind it in pure consciousness. And you can see all this happening. What will happen if you suddenly do this? Well, some people say you turn crazy. You'll become insane. I agree. You'll become very crazy. That all these years, I took it as all real. I took these people as real. I took my children as my children. I didn't know they were children of my body. I took my house as my house. I did not know it belonged to my body. It doesn't belong to me at all. That none of the things that I was thinking are mine were ever mine. They were all part of the movie. And one day the show ends and you go home. So how much of my attention I was putting into an area which was not real, not mine, and I could not carry it even if I wanted to. I had a very interesting dream once when I was young. At that time, money meant a lot of things to me. I won a lottery in a dream. $5 million won in a dream. I'd never seen that kind of money. I went to collect the money. And they said, do you want a check or do you want cash? Cash. And they began to heap up those bills, dollar bills in a heap. I was about to pick up and I woke up. I was so distressed, I said, I must go back to sleep again. This is the truth about ourselves. We get so attached to the characters, objects of a dream, of this physical world, that we do not want to go anywhere else. Even though there are so many ups and downs in this, we fall sick, we become poor, we have a lot of problems here, we get we get emotional distresses. Our best friend leaves us for no reason. We are dissed all the time by people. And there's no real love we discover. All these disappointments we are putting up with because we're taking them as real. And if we were to take these as a movie, what would happen? Would we really become insane or crazy? No. We would be able to look at life as a movie and enjoy it. The ups and downs of a movie make it more exciting. It does not make it less exciting. The extremes of a movie make it worth more than the ordinary movie where there is nothing to excite us. That is why we have been placed in a life where if we were to look at it as a movie, it will change. Our whole approach, our whole state of happiness and joy and bliss changes with that. What we call happiness and joy and bliss, which is our goal, all of us want that. And that can be achieved by realizing, by actual experience, by going within, watching the movie from within and discovering how it is taking place. If one can do that, the rest of this life and any other life or any other future becomes so enjoyable, we can't call it anything less than ultimate bliss. When people talk of a blissful state, that's the blissful state. A state in which you can relax and watch the movie. Now, it's not difficult. I'm making it sound that you have to really go to the projector room and all that. No, I can give you a simple way of looking at life as a movie. Get up in the morning, close your eyes, and feel you are sitting on a chair inside behind the eyes. That this is your place to see life. And remain there, relax there, have a nice cushion, nice best cushion, chair, comfortable chair, behind the eyes. You sit and relax there, and then open your eyes and see through the body, through the eyes of the body, a world. It becomes a movie. Don't lose your position there. The secret is not to lose your position where the self operates from behind the eyes at the third eye center. If you can locate yourself there, you solved a very big mystery of life. So the true meditation, a spiritual way of finding the truth, is to go within yourself, within this body of yours. Within this body, because the body is our only reality at this time. If we go somewhere else, then this body will not be our reality. But to start with, we have to go within this body, behind the eyes. Why do I recommend that place behind the eyes? Some people say, why don't you say heart? Why not the heart chakra? The heart chakra seems to be the most important chakra for people who are emotional, who want emotional experiences. I have noticed that. A lot of people get emotional experiences by concentrating their attention on the heart chakra. But we don't see from the heart chakra. We don't locate things from the heart chakra. We don't die in the heart chakra. We die in the brain chakra, in the two-petal lotus, which looks both outside and inside. Even if you want to examine the nature of the six energy centers in us, you'll find that the only center worth examining is the two-petal lotus, which are the two eyes. They look outside, and you go down to the bottom through a yogic practice, come all the way up to the two-petal lotus, they look inside. All the others are duplicates of the same set of centers, awareness centers behind our eyes, energy centers below us. That's a good combination. If you are able to sit inside the head, behind the eyes, and then watch out for the movie, you'll find the reality is inside. This is all a movie. And what will happen? You'll enjoy it. You'll enjoy your own character's game as well as other characters playing that game. It's a remarkable way of looking at life. And if you are going to meditate, that's the way to start anyway. If you want to find the highest truth, what is real? What is permanently real? Who are we? Basic questions of a true seeker. Basic questions. Who are we? Where is our true home? Why are we in a human body? What is the purpose of human life? If you have these basic questions, the answers are found all by withdrawing your attention inside and just starting your journey from there. Of course, it can be a dangerous journey too. Just like we face dangers outside in this world, we come across difficult situations, we have falls, we meet unscrupulous people, we meet dishonest people, and we have many disappointments outside, dangers inside too. To avoid those dangers, it is best to have somebody in whom you can trust, who you love, who can be a permanent friend, and who travels with you when you take that journey. Now that's great if you can have all these conditions met, that you have a friend who goes with you on the journey of truth from behind the eyes right up to totality of consciousness, and who knows the way already, who's already been there, and whose friendship can make you a permanent co-traveler, the greatest thing that can happen. This is what happens when a seeker gets initiated by a perfect living master. A perfect living master is one whose consciousness, whose awareness at all times is consistently knowing all these levels of creation and the totality where it's only one consciousness. It is not that he has to go and find out. There's nothing to go. It's all there. Supposing you have something right here, you say, I'm going to go right here. How can you go? If you are where you are, how can you say, I'm going to go there? I'm going to have a great spiritual journey. People say, let's go on a spiritual journey. And I say, where are you going? To a true home. Where is the true home? Right where you're sitting here. What kind of journey is that? It is not a journey of distance at all. It's not going from one place to another. It's opening up awareness from one level to another, sitting in the same place where you are. You don't go anywhere. You just realize and open up higher and higher awareness till you become aware of everything. As you open up your higher awareness, just by the way construction of this reality and illusion has been done, you will always have one reality in front of you, not multiple realities. When we go to sleep, that's our reality. When we wake up, this is our reality. We go to astral plane, that's the only reality. Everything else dreamlike. We go to the causal plane of the mind, that's the only reality. You rise above, everything was unreal, the soul is only real. You go above the soul, totality is only real, nothing else is real. But when you merge in totality into oneness, of one consciousness, in which the whole thing has started, then you are aware of everything at the same time. This is their advantage that these perfect living masters have over us, that they are constantly aware of all these levels. For them, all the levels are real and unreal at the same time, because they know the purpose of creation. The purpose of creation was to have different series of experiences at different levels. It has been achieved. All forms of life have been created for different experiences. And one form out of 8.4 species, 8.4 billion species, one form has been reserved for getting out of the whole mess, getting out of creation and going back to the Creator. And that form happens to be the human form. It's only in the human form you can become a seeker by virtue of a strange device, most magical device, a most magical device of becoming a seeker. And what is the magical device? Magical device is the mind can assume that it has to make a choice to be a seeker or not to be a seeker. Free will. The experience of free will is the magical thing given to us by which we choose. We select to become a seeker or not to become a seeker. To say we want to go home or we don't want to go home. This ability put into the mind to make choices is what is so unique. No other form of life, no other form of existence of consciousness anywhere in the universe, or this universe or any universe, exists equal to this. Plants can do it, cats do it, insects can do it, birds can do it, mammals can't do it, angels can't do it, gods can't do it. These, because they have no free will to choose, their mind is not functioning on a basis of free will. And the higher forms, angels and all, they know everything. If you knew everything, your free will disappear at once. If you knew what is going to happen the next 5 minutes and can see it beforehand, your free will will disappear. You will find that this was already decided, what you thought, you are making a choice. Therefore, this unique experience of saying we are going to make a decision whether to seek or not to seek, that unique experience is a secret to going back home. Therefore, it's that same thing, the seeking, that brings a master into our life. And there can be several masters. I want to clarify that also. One should not wait for a perfect living master to arrive before you start the spiritual journey, spiritual awakening. You should start wherever you can. In fact, our scriptures say there are four masters from whom you learn. First is the mother that gives birth to you. The mother is your first teacher, first guru. And then she brings you up to a point where you go to school. And the school teacher becomes your guru, becomes your master. Then you go to a religious belief system. And the religious church person, temple person becomes your guru. Then you do not get satisfied with any of these. Your seeking continues inside and a master comes who says, go within, another guru. Then the master takes you only to the heavens inside at the astral plane and your seeking is still there. That's not what I wanted. I wanted more. Another master appears in your life and takes you further. Your seeking continues. I want to go to totality of consciousness, my true home, to which I really belong, from where I've come. And a perfect living master appears in your life. It's all set up like that. It's all part of our destiny, which we are living in a physical human body. It's amazing that such a good arrangement could be made. I see total perfection in total view of consciousness and its creation. If you see parts of it, it's all imperfect. Just seeing a little bit less than the total makes it imperfect. But when you see the total, it's perfect. Where do you see the total? Only when you become total, when you become totality of consciousness, the ultimate creative power that set everything in motion. So the most wonderful thing about all this is that having been given this opportunity of a human life in order to have free will, and having free will in order to become a seeker, and becoming a seeker and finding a master who can take us within, and having found a master, to proceed with him till he can take us no more and still have the seeking and go further. And ultimately, the ultimate seeking brings a perfect living master and you go back home continuously thinking, he knows more. Maybe he knows more. That's why he knows the way, he knows where I'm going. And he takes you through very strange experiences. And at the end, you find he and you were the same. That you were yourself the master. But you couldn't see yourself, so you projected an image and produced a human being as a master. It's a most remarkable spiritual journey. There's nothing like it. And yet, so many of us are treating this whole opportunity as a philosophy, just as something to debate about what is real, what is unreal. Do we really have free will? Do we don't have free will? You could be debating these subjects for your life. And some people tell me, I can't take even the first step unless I'm satisfied. Then I tell him the story of the guy in India who fell into a well. Those wells don't have parapet walls, so they are flush with the land. So in the darkness, a professor, intellectual professor, a questioning guy like many of us, he fell into the well. And he was moaning and groaning, and a passerby came and he heard some voices. And he came, he said, oh, sorry, you have fallen the well, but lucky the water is not deep. I can go and bring a rope and pull you out. And the philosopher says, no, but first explain to me why I fell into the well. Then you also tell me, how can I trust you that you will bring the rope? And even if you bring the rope, how can I trust you that after lowering the rope, you'll not drop me again? And the guy outside says, look, can't we discuss all these things after you're out of the well? Then we can discuss how you fell into the well. We can discuss why I had to bring a rope. Can't we discuss? No, I won't take anything. I won't even listen to you unless you first convince me that you are a trustworthy guy, that I can have faith in you, that you will really bring the rope. The guy says, okay, then you stay in the well. And that's so many of us are staying in the well with our minds debating this thing. Whereas these perfect living masters come and say, you take one step forward, we'll take 10 steps. Just make a little effort, which also they plant in us. When the destiny is right, they plant the first step in us. And we are still worrying, can we be sure? We can't be totally sure. Why do we say that? Because we identify ourselves with our mind. The mind is a thinking machine. It's a beautiful machine. I can't praise it enough. What a beautiful equipment we have been given. The soul has been given such a beautiful equipment. It can think in words and images and in languages. It can project the whole creation. It can sense things. It can make sense of things. It can use logic in order to come to conclusions. What a wonderful gift to have a computer-like machine like that attached to ourselves, to our souls, our consciousness. And we put our consciousness, the energy to make it alive, to make it work. We give it the power. The soul, our consciousness, gives the power to the mind to become real. And then we start believing we are the mind. Whatever the mind does, arbitrarily, bizarre, we think we are doing it. We think and we start saying, I am thinking. You are not thinking. You are letting your mind think. You are making your mind think. If we can't even understand this basic distinction between ourselves and a cover we are wearing, a machine we are carrying, then we'll be caught up in this all the time. When we think, it's not the I, the self, that is thinking. The self is providing the conscious power to the mind to become alive, and the mind thinks. We make the mind think. And if we knew that part only, that we are the controllers, the power givers to our own minds, that our minds will think the way we want, not what the mind wants to think. If we can just take this control, this much control, by directing the mind what to think, and not letting it go astray, pulling it back. And if it still wants to play foul, let it play foul and you ignore it. If we can do these things with the mind, our spiritual journey will be cut short immediately. Because most of our obstacles in our spiritual journey are our own mind. Our mind, which creates doubts. Of course, we're built to do that. I must tell you, it's a good machine. And we, one of the programs in it is, create doubt on everything. Why is it a good thing to create doubt? Because if there was no doubt, we'd be so credulous. Anybody says something, we'll believe. Somebody else says something else, we'll believe that. We'll never have a chance to screen out something from the other, to screen out the truth. Therefore, it's a good thing we have a machine that makes us skeptics and says, watch out. Watch out. Look at all the alternatives. Be careful. That's what it does. It's a good thing that the mind doubts. But if we begin to believe that the mind is our own self, then we are in doubt all the time. Not our machine is using to warn us. We become the warning to ourselves. Not only that, the mind, when it doubts, it creates the next consequence of doubt, which is fear. We are afraid. We are never afraid if we are not doubtful. Doubt creates fear. So we live a life of insecurity. We pass our show, this whole show which we should be enjoying, we're sitting in a state of insecurity, in fear. We don't know what will happen. Anything can happen. The mind comes up with strange nightmares at night and daymares. And day. I don't know if there's a word called daymare. Anyway. But we are constantly frightened by this mind. Why are we frightened? Because we don't realize the mind is not us. We are the soul, the spirit, consciousness, not the thinking machine. And we can use the thinking machine the way we want. And that requires that instead of allowing the mind to exercise a mental will, we should use a spiritual will to overcome even the mind. A spiritual will is built when the soul asserts, and mind's mental will is built when the mind asserts in our life. The mind asserts through the process of thinking. The soul asserts through intuitive knowledge, through coincidences. Coincidences and intuitive knowledge, they are the assertive tools of the soul. When we live our life with intuitive knowledge, knowing, what is intuition telling us, gut feeling telling us, and make the mind act according to that, life changes immediately. You can experiment with these things. What I am saying is for application, not for study only and not for debating about it, but application. That you go within and assert your spiritual will over the mind, and you will get so much control over the mind. Mind will do what you want it to do. So I've told those stories about how to control the mind like a genie, but to be controlled in Aladdin's story, and other ways I've been explaining in other talks. But we have to realize first, before we can do any of these things, we are not the mind. Mind is a thinking machine we are using, and we can use it the way we like. And that little practice is required to give directions to the mind what to think. Directions to the mind what to speak, what not to speak, what to think, what not to think, and keep at bay when you're trying to get something higher than the mind. I hope all of you will try to get to the right place behind the eyes and verify the statements that I am making for you. And verify what I am sharing with you. It's all verifiable by each one of you. All you have to do is, don't take the body as yourself. It is not. It's temporary, only covering yourself. Don't take your sense perceptions as a way to determine the truth. Those are also covers upon yourself. Don't take thinking with the mind as yourself. That's also a machine given to you. Remember, you are the consciousness, the power that works these three things, that makes these three work, the mind, the senses, and the physical body, to create a life experience for you. You are in control as the soul and the spirit. Get into that position. Start from behind the eyes. Every morning, make it a priority. Every night before sleeping, 5 minutes morning, 5 minutes night, or more if you can find time, and you'll find the verification of what I've been telling you. Thank you very much for coming and letting me share my experiences with you. We'll have a break. I'll come back here about 3 o'clock and answer any questions if you have. Thank you very much.